In an era of shifting global powers, the United States Navy and Marine Corps stand on the brink of transformation. Their focus, a nimble new amphibious vessel known as the medium landing ship, once called the Light Amphibious Warship. Designed to navigate island chains, transport Marines, and project power ashore, these ships herald a bold vision for modern naval warfare. The Navy's medium landing ship program aims to build up to 35 new amphibious ships, essential platforms that will transport and sustain Marines across contested waters. Previously known as the Light Amphibious Warship, or LAW, this program gained momentum as the Marine Corps reimagined how its forces might fight in the future. Today, the Navy's proposed fiscal year 2025 budget has requested $268.1 million for the very first ship in this new class, setting the stage for a massive undertaking that could reshape America's maritime footprint for decades to come. Amphibious operations are woven into our military history, from the beaches of Normandy to the remote islands of the Pacific. But as power dynamics shift and new threats emerge, particularly in the Western Pacific, the Marines need versatile ships that can operate in small teams across vast island chains. Enter the LSM, the perfect vessel to implement Expeditionary Advanced Base Operations, or EABO. The big picture, EABO, and force design. The EABO concept envisions small, agile marine units hopping from island to island, launching anti-ship cruise missiles, and conducting key missions alongside the Navy. These dispersed forces create a puzzle for any adversary, especially in the Western Pacific, where potential friction points with China loom. The LSM will deliver and re-embark these marine units, making it the backbone of this new approach. EABO is just one element in the broader force design plan, a sweeping reorganization of the Marine Corps aimed at countering modern threats. By fielding small, fast units with advanced missiles and drones, the Marine Corps can impose a lethal dilemma on an adversary. Any attempt to seize control of key waterways risks coming under fire from multiple unexpected locations. Behind the name, LSM, formerly LAW. Originally called the Light Amphibious Warship, the program has since been rebranded as the Medium Landing Ship, LSM. In January 2025, the Navy announced the first of these ships, LSM-1, would be christened McClung, honoring Major Megan M. McClung, the first female Marine officer killed in action in Iraq and the first female graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy to fall in the line of duty. This new class is officially named the McClung Class, though the Navy has yet to declare a formal naming rule for subsequent hulls. Program status, funding, and procurement. So how does the Navy plan to buy these ships, and what do they cost? Under current proposals, FY 2025, the first LSM at $268.1 million, FY 2026, the second ship at $200 million FY 2027, the third and fourth ships together at $349.5 million total. The first ship always costs more because it bears the detailed design and non-recurring engineering costs for the entire class. But compared to the Navy's much larger amphibious ships, the LSM will be relatively inexpensive. A big deck amphibious assault ship, LHA/LHD, can cost upwards of $3.8 billion to build, while the LPD 17 Flight 2 ships come in around $2 billion. The LSM, at somewhere around $150 to $300 million apiece, marks a major cost reduction. What makes the LSM different? Picture a vessel 200 to 400 feet in length with a 12-foot draft, able to beach itself on gentle shorelines. A typical LSM might carry 50 Marines plus 648 short tons of their gear and then deliver them directly onto the beach. It's armed with two 30mm guns and multiple .50 caliber weapons, boasts a helicopter landing pad, and travels at a modest 14 knots, trading speed for fuel efficiency and a simpler, cheaper propulsion plan. The real magic, however, lies in how these ships will tuck themselves into archipelagos and littoral zones, hidden by geography and allied shipping traffic. Small marine detachments come and go with minimal port infrastructure, setting up advanced bases armed with anti-ship missiles, and then melting away at a moment's notice. While historically, large amphibious ships have emerged from a single yard, like Huntington Ingalls Industries in Mississippi, the Navy has invited multiple potential builders for the LSM, a move that could speed production and reduce costs. In late 2024, however, the Navy paused its request for proposals after preliminary bids overshot the cost estimates. They're now exploring a non-developmental vessel approach, tapping existing commercial or military designs that need only minor tweaks. We had what we believed was a bulletproof cost estimate, but the bids came back much higher. we decided to pull back, refine our requirements, and look at proven hulls to keep affordability on track. Risk, cost, and schedule concerns. Lawmakers will have to decide whether to approve, reject, or modify this program, especially as costs fluctuate. Questions persist about whether the Navy's unit cost estimates are too optimistic. The Congressional Budget Office suggests an average cost of up to $340 to $430 million per ship, far beyond the Navy's current estimate. Why the disparity? Lead ships often exceed initial forecasts, and ongoing design debates over survivability, range, and cargo space can drive up expenses. Congressional oversight also extends to the broad force design concept driving the LSM's creation. Some question whether EABO focuses too narrowly on a potential showdown with China, possibly at the expense of other global commitments. Others ask how these new Marine units will stay supplied and protected, and whether alternative platforms, like existing Army logistics support vessels, might cover some or all of the requirement at lower cost. Force design and EABO debates. The Marine Corps insists the EABO strategy opens new frontiers in distributed sea denial, using small teams to confound any aggressor's ability to find and hit U.S. forces. But critics worry about vulnerabilities and the challenge of maintaining these platoon-sized units on scattered islands. For Congress, it's a balancing act. Either fully invest in these specialized vessels or redirect funds to other priorities. Alternatives and bridging solutions. Meanwhile, the Marine Corps has publicly considered bridging solutions until the first LSM is ready, like using older Army watercraft or leasing commercial stern landing vessels. The Army's logistics support vessels, LSVS, and landing craft utility, LCU, can already carry vehicles onto a beach. Could reallocated Army craft fill the gap without building entirely new ships? Possibly, but they lack certain EABO-specific features, like advanced sensors, survivability upgrades, and the right cargo capacity. Still, these bridging solutions can offer valuable real-world experimentation, testing tactics, load configurations, and day-to-day routine for Marines working in the littorals. Every lesson learned here will shape the final LSM design. Industrial and economic impact. Another key concern, industrial base implications. Building large amphibious ships typically funnels billions into a single shipyard, but the LSM spread could support multiple small and medium-sized yards. This might bolster competition, foster innovation, and lower costs, but it could also reduce the workflow at legacy amphibious shipbuilders. The final solution, whether a single yard or multiple, will have ripple effects on local economies, job creation, and long-term shipbuilding capacity. The road ahead. As the Navy and Marine Corps push forward, the medium landing ship could be a game changer or a cautionary tale. Decisions made by Congress in the coming months will help determine whether the LSM accelerates America's shift to distributed maritime operations or struggles under mounting costs and evolving requirements. Few programs embody the evolving nature of 21st century warfare better than the medium landing ship. It's smaller, it's cheaper, it's lighter on its feet, yet it carries the hopes of an ambitious Marine Corps modernization strategy, bridging doctrine with new technology. If the Navy and Marine Corps get this right, the McClung Class LSM will rewrite the playbook for amphibious ops, helping ensure the United States remains a global maritime leader on island beaches and beyond. We hope this deep dive has illuminated the twists, turns, and triumphs of the medium landing ship program. Stay tuned as Congress deliberates, shipyards refine designs, and the Marines prepare to land where they're needed, whenever and wherever that may be.